in Amsterdam. And there I was so careless to announce that I was planning something with computer art. Okay, and today I would like to tell you what I have done so far since 2015. I have to say in advance that I'm not a computer scientist and I'm not an artist. I'm just a retired educational technologist with a growing interest now in computer art and its programming. And in the meantime, I've learned a little bit about that, about computer art and as well as its programming, and I decided to share my experience with you. I will talk about, of course, a definition. What is computer art? Because that's not so clear. And why I did recoding and remixing computer art, and what are the graphic elements and programming concepts, including a small toolbox for graphics. And I will finish with some remarks why I've chosen Snap. And of course, also this presentation will have an outlook, a last slide announcing what I'm planning from now. By the way, all the graphics shown on the right of my slides in this presentation are recodings of typical works of the pioneers of early computer art, and as such a tribute or an homage to those pioneers. Okay, what I'm talking about when I'm using the term computer art, this is a definition from Wikipedia. Computer art is any art in which computers play a role in production or display of the artwork. So this definition applies on the one hand to the software that are the programs with which the data to be displayed are generated, and on the other hand, the hardware, that is the computers on which the programs are running, as well as the output devices with which the data are displayed as perceptible artifacts at the end. In our context, however, it's more important that computer art is also a direction in art, a genre in art, that lasted from 1965 to about 1980. The software then ran on mainframe computers and the results were output on plotters. For example, the SUSE Graphomat on the left, Z64, shown here, that was a plotter of choice for the German computer artists. And especially in Germany, we had many of those pioneers. After a short flowering period of about 15 years, computer art disappeared already again from the scene. But since some years, interest has reawakened, and its role as precursor of modern media art, characterized by multimedia and interactivity, is now well recognized. Okay, but why did I start recoding and remixing computer art? Well, at my retirement some years ago, I decided to pick up two old hobbies again, to do programming and to deal with art. I have worked professionally as an educational technologist, and as such, I got to know very early the programming language Logo. And by the way, I did my first programming with it using the MIT logo for the Apple II, and that was an already amazingly powerful version of Logo. For my Logo revival, I was looking for a suitable actual Logo version, and I found it with ACS Logo for the Apple Macintosh, and the first result of my efforts was a booklet. So it was called Volume 1 on Programming Interactive Graphics, with examples like polygons and spirals, L systems or spiral laterals, and producing nice graphics. You can download it from my website, but I have to warn you, it's written in German. So I have stopped Volume 2, only half finished, because now the art came into play. At the time, my daughter studied at Friedrich-Naake in Bremen. As she told me, he was one of the pioneers in the so-called computer art, which I had then only known casually. And so I got to know the pictures from this period of art history. And these are some examples. I found the similarity of these images to typical images made with a turtle graphic of logo quite amazing. And I thought to program, to reprogram, to recode early computer art with logo should actually be relatively simple. And so my interest in programming merged with my interest in art. And to just, as I just mentioned, Frieder Nake has characterized this twofold approach in brief and to the point, my opinion. The digital image exists as a double, the surface, which is visible for humans, and the subface, which is computable by software. Yesterday, I've learned from a native English-speaking guy, subface is not an English word. I don't know. So it meant the background, the basis of that. And in my project to recode and remix such pictures, that can be considered as a trial to treat the surface and the subface of the digital images equally important. Of course, I'm not the first nor the only one to recode and to remix computer art or other art genres. Shortly after the end of the first flowering period of computer art, there were some books appearing intended to introduce into the reconstruction of this art direction. For example, Schneeberger, one of the German pioneers, he used the Fortran library to produce his graphics. Wilson, an American, he used BASIC at the time, which was available on most microcomputers. And the latest efforts to make the historical works of computer art accessible that can be found on the net. For example, the Recode project has set itself the task to preserve computer art by translating it into a modern programming language. And that language is processing. And there is another project, Recode Art, that concentrates in a similar way on the work of the mentioned Rainer Schneeberger. And here, too, the implementation is carried out in with processing. And both projects contribute to the preservation of digital art. So if you go to the Scratch community and in the Explore section, there you can find various relevant collections, for example, studios on computer art, digital art, on Selim Tezel's art projects, as well as collections of projects with Mondrian-like or Riley-like paintings. And I'm sure there are more examples if you do more search. Okay, the definition of computer art has already been introduced, and now it's time to name some typical properties. My procedure to determine them was as follows. I tried first to find as many examples as possible. That was not always easy because the documentation of computer art is very sparse and it's seldom object of a museum's collection. So what I did with my still growing collection was the following. There is analysis. Which patterns and structures are characteristically for those images. From that resulted a compendium of the graphic elements, which are typical, like points, lines, or more complex structures. Then the analysis of whether and which recurrent patterns are recognizable in these examples. And finally, the analysis of random deviations concerning the forms of the objects, the number of elements, and the arrangement of objects. And I have to say, by the way, this analytical approach has changed my view of the works of modern art in general, in the stylistic direction of concept art or suprematism or op art. Especially geometric abstraction, very often series of recurring patterns and structures are found and attempting to reconstruct them algorithmically like the computer art. You have seen some examples already on the preceding slides. On this slide are further examples, which are very typical examples by some of the pioneers like Michael Knoll, an American physicist, Georg Nees, a German engineer, and Vera Molnar, a French painter. And you see, most of the pioneers were not artists. Vera Molnar is an exception, but most of them were engineers, mathematicians, technicians who had the opportunity to use plotters and the machines to produce what they called aesthetic objects. They didn't speak of art at that time. So the examples on the last slide illustrate almost completely the list of typical graphical elements which can be found in early computer art. They had the restriction on the colors black and white, because to plot with colors was rather awkward to handle at that time. The use of lines as well as line hatching, the use of squares, polygons, circles, and so on. And there's also a set of structural characteristics of those works. That is the use of the name simple basic elements and the repetition of these elements, the variation of those elements, and very often the use of random values for setting selected image properties. So the next step for me was to develop a syllabus based on those graphical elements and structural characteristics, and to combine them with computational thinking practices. So like analyzing problems and artifacts, and that is in our case the analysis of the many examples of early computer art. Then abstracting, that is what we already did with a description of the structural characteristics. Then algorithms, so which we have to formulate for the recoding of an example and creating computational artifacts, that is to translate the algorithms into programs which produce the desired graphics. So I have tried to pull all this together, and the result, or to be more precise, there will be the book Coded Art in German. As I'm a great advocate of visual coding, the language of my choice was Snap, but I have to say, I think 95% of my examples can also be realized with Scratch, but there are another 5% where you need Snaps. And a reason for me is also that my addressees are not only, but mainly, older people like myself. Not least because of that, I have placed great value on introducing all language elements in the case they are required for producing a concrete project. So I wanted to avoid learning ahead. And at the end, I was astonished myself that this was possible from the early beginning. And to illustrate that, I want to show you the first examples. Of course, in all projects, graphics will be produced, and of course, we need as an indispensable basis a set of total graphics command. Fortunately, these are very intuitive with its natural geometry, and that's also important for older people with no mathematical background. And of course, it's necessary to bring the command in a meaningful order of steps, that is sequencing. So there we have to start, but then already in the next step we can use, we can try to recode a real example of early computer art. This is Rhythms by Erwin Steller, a German artist. In addition to the turtle graphics command, you only need an iteration, the repeating of a series of instructions, and that's actually all you need for this example. My second example is by Roger Wilder. I think he's from the Netherlands, and it's made of a lot of rectangles, and of course it calls for simplification. Therefore, at this point, we have to introduce variables and procedures. And with this small generalization, it's very easy to generate Wilder's variations on 9 squares. Let's have a look at the third example. This is by Bridget Riley, not a computer artist, but recoded at the beginning of computer art by Michael Knowles, an American computer artist. And he took Bridget Riley's movement in squares as an example from op art, showing an optical illusion. And to achieve this, in addition to the previous commands, now control structures and conditional statements are required, and thus it's possible to define the boundaries at which the rectangles change the increase and decrease of their widths. And that's really everything you need up to this point. And in a similar way, further concepts can be introduced like randomness, recursion, lists, event handling, messaging, cloning, etc. Always with a real example from a computer artist, and then introduce the next concept to do that. Okay, and when something is missing, we are able to add it by writing a new procedure. And for our purposes, I have added a special graphic library, which include procedures for different point shapes. That's very useful in these examples and other examples. And sometimes you are astonished how various points you need to make such graphics. Then I have a set of procedures for different lines, and also very amazing how different they can be determined if you try to reproduce such examples. And finally, procedures for different arcs and circles. Although these more or less rarely occur in early computer art, I think plotters then were not so good in drawing circles and arcs due to the technical restrictions at that time. Okay, equipped with such a toolbox, a wide range of examples of early computer art now can be recoded and remixed, because remixing is the next step after recoding. And the remixing can affect the structure. That's, for example, the case in the picture of Georg Nees on the left, or it can affect colors and the type of random distribution. That's an example of Stroiken, that's second on the left. And you see already that, for example, color totally makes a totally different appearance of such a graphic. The third case of Sikora affects the shapes and the colors, and finally, on the right side, it affects the number of elements and the colors, as the example is taken from Vera Molnar, which I mentioned already. And the range of possibilities to remix the example is nearly limitless. Okay, we have seen earlier the characteristics which are associated, and also the limited possibilities of early computer art, and that was mostly due to the technical restrictions at that time, the available hard and software, and the rapid disappearance of computer art after about 12 or 15 years certainly can be ascribed also to these limitations. But these restrictions no longer apply. Today there is color with highest resolution. We have large, really very large, even huge output devices. On Monday, the wall of a building was the output device. Interactivity is enabled through a variety of input options. We have advanced controls available and much more. So this is why one of the pioneers, the earlier mentioned Friedel Nahrke, now says himself that it's computer art at the height of the time must be in motion, whether it's a dynamic installation or an interaction with the environment. And I found the introduction of interactive elements of sensors and feedback has interesting implications. Now the viewers are included in the work of art, they become contributors. And this type of objects and installations also can be realized with a presented means. For example, animations, this is a project of Van Bechel, I hope I spelled it right, from the Netherlands. That's very easy. Sometimes it seems to me it's really trivial to reproduce these early things. But nowadays, animations, for example, are almost indispensable in installations. So if you want to control it by the viewer, that can be carried out in the simplest case by inputting values within the program. So in such a case, the viewer must have access to parts of the code in order to change these inputs. But far more flexible is the use of microcontrollers like the BBC microbit. Yesterday in the poster session, I have shown it in an example, not using Snap, but ScratchX. And in this example, an homage at Thalmann, which was not done with the help of computers at his time, but it was a mechanical installation. In this example, I have made kind of a tiny game console, the same I have shown yesterday in the poster session, and using the buttons, the motion sensors, and the accelerometer of the controller board, the various attributes of the animation can be controlled. Okay, I hope I could show you that without greater difficulties, interactive installations are possible now for really everybody. Or I like to alterate a quote of Josef Beuys, famous German artist and theoretician of art, and he said, everybody is an artist. And now we can claim everybody is a computer artist or a multimedia artist. And in my experience, not only playful applications can be created this way, but also serious objects of high quality, which can even be shown in exhibitions and multimedia festivals. I've done it several times in the meantime. Okay, as I said, most projects can be also realized with Scratch, but some features and attributes can make life easier and improve the results. That was important for me because I needed really big pictures for exhibitions and interactive exhibits at festivals. And at such events, for example, standalone executables, which can be built with SnapP, are extremely helpful. And last but not least, without the help and the enthusiasm of Jens, I probably would not have started my project on recoding and remixing computer art in this way. So special thanks to Jens. And in the last session, I've learned from Yoshiki, and also on the first day there was a presentation on NetBlocks. So I learned that it would be possible with Snap to design computer art collaboratively now. I think I already have many ideas how to use that now. So I come to my last slide. And referring to my Scratch 2015 contribution, I can show two results. There is now my website, Digital Art, including a digital art gallery, which is even in English. And the book on coding art is nearly finished, the German version. I hope there will be an English version at some time, but I'm not sure what I can do for that, because I have already a second book in my head with a similar approach as a work in progress, and this time it will be about optical illusions. And there also you have dozens or hundreds of examples, and they are in many books, but books are static, and if you search in the web, there are some animations, but they are mainly non-interactive, and I have a thousand ideas how to make optical illusions highly interactive in a similar way than as the computer art. So I'm curious myself what I can report on the next conference. Thank you.
I think we have a few minutes for questions. I can pass the microphone to people if you have any questions you'd like to ask.
Are there also examples of code available on your site?
Well, you are German speaking. I have on the mentioned website also the documentation of two exhibitions, and there you can find code snippets how it's done. Not the total code. And so I'm waiting for the Snap community, like the Scratch community, to put all that on the web. At the moment, it's a bit uncomfortable. But if you want the code of special examples, you can have it, of course.
Okay.
It's the intention to remix that. So of course, I want to offer you the code.
In the beginning, you spoke about reinventing the code for existing work of art. You did it yourself, but is there also a computer way to do that, examining art and finding out a pattern and reprogramming it?
As I said, I'm not an computer scientist, maybe. What you find in several advanced projects is to reproduce the style of certain painters by analyzing their style and then with artificial intelligence procedures, and then to reproduce it. So there are several electric painters drawing in the style of Van Gogh or whatever, because they have extracted typical structures. There is one computer artist named Cohen. He did that for the first time without artificial intelligence, but with human intelligence. He produced several procedures of his own drawing style, and the program was called Aaron. And that program produced without his influence at the end paintings. But of course, the style of the paintings was what he has produced with the program.
Yeah, question for me. The old art, we do not know actually how the artists work. The examples you shown, there was a computer code, an original code. Are they still available?
So op art mainly is not done by computers, but by hand. Richard Riley was painting it, and Vasarely was painting it. But of course, they had algorithms to do that. For example, Vasarely had a painting factory, you can say, and he defined the algorithms, and then that was painted after him. Or Sol Levitt is the best example of concrete of concept art. He made the instructions. He left. He stayed in America, and in Brussels, in an exhibition, assistants painted after his instructions on the wall. Very famous wall paintings, which is concepts, which are algorithms. The algorithm of the original computer art, you can't find it. So I've searched really intensively, and I know Friedrich Nahrke and Rainer Schneeberger now, and I asked them. I succeeded with Georg Nees. Too late, I've already done most of the work, but Georg Nees has published a dissertation in the late 60s, and there are some of the algorithms, especially of the first slide, Gravel, which is one of my favorite pictures. You can find it there. And interesting enough, I had produced my recoding after analysis of the picture, and that was a recursive solution. I did recursion to make that. And in his original algorithm, it's just a simple iteration. So you can find the same result on different ways. It's also an interesting input to talk to people or to teach people that it's not always one way for a solution. So there are very few algorithms available, mostly not usable because they use dead languages. Sometimes you find how it's called pseudocode, so verbal descriptions, but not the computer program. So at the end, you have to analyze it yourself. But I found it very interesting for myself. And as I said, I now have a different view on modern art when they are abstract with graphical abstractions. And I always look at the principles behind that. And sometimes I sit down and make the algorithm or the program of that.
So I think maybe just do one last question, because I still have to talk afterwards, and I don't want to rush too much.
Well, I'm very impressed with everything you've shown, and personally very excited about this. What's your experience with children, especially younger children? Do they care about this or get excited when they see these kinds of programs and the kinds of artwork that emerges from the programs?
I have no experience with pupils. As I said, I work with older people. But I think as a similarity of the early computer art and typical logographics is so evident. I think it's you can take them on the way to understand art on that. Not with very young pupils, but at school, and that should be possible, I think. And for some, I think it's a more motivational way to learn about programming as with other things.
Sorry, I will not take the time.
No, thank you so much.